Right.
Hi, welcome to the opening ceremony of the 7th International Conference of the Spanish Association for the Interdisciplinary Studies of India, or India Studies, titled Indian Roots and Roots in Global Times, Cartographies of Independence, Diaspora, and Resilience. This event has been possible because of the support of the Ministry of Culture and Foreign Affairs of India, as well as the Embassy of India in Madrid. We are hereby celebrating the 65th anniversary of independence. And also this event, which is taking place online, is possible because of the gratitude that we want to show to University of Cantabria, Universidad de Cantabria. They offered the help to organize this conference at their institution. Yet, even though we are using this online platform, they've been facilitating that this is possible. And now that everybody is connected and we are recording this opening, I would like to invite the people on this virtual table today. And we're going to start with the opening ceremony, starting with the Honorable Ambassador of India, Mr. Sanjay Verma. Then we would listen to Alfredo Moro Martín as representative of the University of Cantabria. And then you will get to listen to Mónica Fernández, the co-director of the conference, as well as myself. My name is Jorge Diego Sánchez, and I will be speaking as contemporary or the current secretary of the association, of the Spanish Association for the Interdisciplinary Studies of India, as well as co-director of the event. Before we let the Honorable Ambassador of India in Spain speak, I would like to congratulate, you know, that today we are devoting a little bit of time to gather human beings on this virtual platform. And this is something that feels like, I don't know, as if we were going to light up a fire or do something human in the midst of this day. And something as magic as that in a conference, I think that it's more or less facilitated by all of you being here. So thank you for that. And now the floor is all for the Honorable Ambassador of India in Spain, Mr. Sanjay Verma.
Well, thank you, Jorge. Namaste, hola. It gives me a great pleasure to see so many friends again, and over a wonderful event, which is so timely as it is amidst the period where we celebrate or mark 75 years of Indian independence, which is ironic because as a civilization, we go back 5,000 years, but as a nation state, we are just about 75 years old. And in that context, let me begin by acknowledging and appreciating the role of the University of Cantabria and the Spanish Association for the Interdisciplinary Study of India. This is probably a 7th edition, and for having put it all together and having chosen a wonderful topic. I think I must say again that Indian roots and roots, cartographies of independence, diaspora, and resilience is poetry. And it's poetry, this sounds poetry, but we will deep dive into the prose of India's past, connecting its history, its geography, migration of its people, and also, and very importantly, examining, and I hope all of your speakers will use the occasion to focus on the India of today and how India is placed in the fast-changing, fast-morphing geopolitical, geo-economic, geo-energy map of the world. So in that context, where does this country go? And you know, what are the expectations? Secondly, how does India relate with Spain? What is that relationship with Europe? What are the common values? Can we move ahead together? So the future is as important as the present and understanding the roots of the past. India is in a very, very exciting phase. And I sometimes envy my young diplomats who have colleagues who have just joined the foreign service that you are, when I look back 30 years ago when I joined the Indian Foreign Service, I mean, there was a certain amount of pessimism. We are on the back foot. But over the last 20 odd years, things have changed significantly. I mean, let's begin from the diaspora. I mean, I can in honesty say that till about 20 odd years ago, for the diaspora all over the world, and these are about 30 odd million people, if they were all together, I think it would be the 40th biggest country or 43rd biggest country of the world. For them, India was a liability in that sense 20, 30 years ago, because you know, it was a country which was struggling, finding its feet, etc. But today, the adage of India to an Indian diaspora is a wonderful visiting calling card. It's an asset. In fact, if you say you're part of the Indian diaspora, people expect you to be very smart. Your, at least your IT skills and your English language skills, etc., your business competence, you know, is something which is a given and is expected. And why not? Because if you look at the of the political map around the world, the fact that you have a vice president in the US of Indian origin, you have the prime minister in Portugal of Indian origin. Till a couple of years back, the prime minister of Ireland was of Indian origin. In England today, you have four very important secretaries or ministers, including the finance minister, the interior minister, etc., who are of Indian origin. You look in the business world, I mean, Microsoft, Google, the COO of Zoom, this platform we are using, is a young Indian girl, you know, the chief operating officer, or the IMF chief economist. I mean, I was looking at the Financial Times weekend supplement in which they have rounded up the books of the year, you know, the editor's recommendation, etc. And I wasn't surprised to see that at least 15 to 20% of all the books listed across fiction, science, economy, politics, had Indian origin writers, part of the diaspora from the US, from the UK. So I think there is great energy in the Indian diaspora and they take great strength. And so does India. For us, diaspora is now a very important and fundamental pillar of India's foreign policy. There is an outreach where the government focuses on the diaspora. And it's a fantastic relationship. And in the US and UK, these are very, very strong lobbies for us. So, you know, that is the diaspora. Where does India stand today? Let me begin by briefly saying that the COVID situation is well under control. The second wave, which hit the headlines and made it appear far worse than it was, in my view, it is because sometimes when we look at funeral rites of cultures which are not ours, you know, it's very difficult for a Hindu to accept that after death, the body is buried. For a non-Hindu to see mortal remains being consigned to flames is abhorrent. It's the whole idea. So in the second wave, when these images, and these were genuine images, but the fact is when these images of bodies piled up at funeral pyres, it had a multiplier effect, which was not just about numbers. It is about deepening of a memory, which goes beyond the scale. And so the point I'm making it, while the numbers, it really hit us very badly, it wasn't so bad. It was projected far more worse than what the situation was. But coming down to the present today, our numbers are back to March 2020. I mean, that is the situation today. Schools have opened, theaters have opened, domestic airlines are serving food in the aircraft. So, I mean, you know, that says it all. When the COVID-19 crisis broke, we had one lab which could conduct tests for COVID-19. Today, we are inoculating up to 20 million people a day from near zero PPE kits. Today, we are the world's second biggest manufacturers of PPE kits. We have exported about 70 million plus vaccines. We have inoculated 1.2 billion people already. So, you know, this is the sort of control we have been able to, manage over the COVID-19 crisis. That apart, we also use this COVID-19 period to consolidate the economy. A lot of reforms required, whether it was privatization or cleaning up of the banking sector or financial inclusion using digital tools, we undertook that. And the advantage is that we are now projected by the IMF, et cetera, to grow at 9.5% this year. And India will be the world's one of the world's fastest growing big economies for the next 2, 3, 4 years coming. Last quarter, we grew at 22%. I mean, that is mind-boggling. Of course, from a very low base, but that suggests how keyed up we are and how raring to be, you know, all the indicators of production, electricity consumption, domestic travel numbers, you know, they're all hitting the pre-COVID figures. So that is to suggest that, you know, India is back in business. Internationally, Indo-Pacific is the new area of contestation. We see ourselves at the heart of the new Indo-Pacific. And here, if I may add, is that, you know, we are at a very exciting space. We are actually the frontier of democracy and free market and a liberal system, rule of law. And I think European country, the West recognizes that increasingly, that in that part of the world, we are actually the flag bearers of values which Europe holds dearly, which Spain holds dearly. And, you know, that is going to be the fulcrum and the anchor on which our relationship is going to move forward. May I now also briefly talk about India and Spain? The last 3 years I've been here, I personally had a very enjoyable and professionally satisfying tenure. Half of it was spent behind a mask, but in that 18, 20 months, I've been able to see a lot of the country, and there have been key movements forward. Let's begin by something very small, like the president of Spain, Pedro Sanchez, greeting the Indian community in Spain on Diwali. It's never happened. He did that. It was a small gesture, but somewhere it suggests the, you know, recognition of the Indian community, recognition of India, its traditions, its culture. On the back of it was one of the biggest defense deals India has signed with this part of the world, where we gave an order to Airbus Spain to manufacture about 56 aircrafts, military aircrafts to be manufactured by Airbus Spain for India, a deal worth about $2.6 billion. And whenever a deal of this nature takes place, it suggests that there is growing confidence between countries, that they have reached a level where the engagement encompasses strategic and sensitive areas as defense, technology, etc. Just about 10 days ago or 2 weeks ago, there was an announcement that Cintra, the Spanish company, will be investing up to $400 million in the Indian infrastructure sector. And they're doing it because India plans to invest about $1.3 trillion in its infrastructure pipeline, you know, airports, railways, roads, ports. So, you know, this is just to suggest that Spain is now beginning to look at India, as is India, increasingly focused on ensuring that our relationship with Spain, which is otherwise, you know, free of any controversies or any sticky issues. We have a growing convergence on international issues. We vote regularly, coinciding our interests in the UN system. We have the same position on human rights, etc., or global trade. European Union, we find Spain is increasingly becoming a partner, a supporter for India in this very important forum. And in fact, Spain was one of the leading countries in ensuring that the trade negotiations between India and EU, both trade and investment trade negotiations, were supported by Spain. So all in all, you know, that is a great relationship. What gives me comfort is that culturally and academically, I think we had a very decent base to begin with. There is a high comfort level in the space of culture and academia between India and Spain, and that will only grow, and that has been steadfast. You know, it's never seen decline significantly, but now with the growing political, defense, economic relationship, which will be crowned by hopefully the visit of the President Sanchez to India sometime next year. So that would, you know, take our relationship even further. A few more words on India today. Lesser recognized facts about what India is focusing on. The first is that we have one of the world's biggest public information systems. 1.3 billion people are part of a unique digital program called Aadhaar. We have about 800 million internet users, 750 million smartphone users. We are looking at connecting 600,000 Indian villages with broadband. Financial inclusivity using digital modes is where the government is focusing on. Subsidies are transferred through bank accounts or through handsets, etc. So this is the new India. The ecosystem for startups is one of the healthiest. We have the third highest number of unicorns in the world. Every week or two, you know, there's a unicorn which comes up. And the example I would like to give at this point is of a company called Nykaa, run by a middle-aged Indian businesswoman who used to work for a MNC, for a multinational corporation, till about 3 or 4 years ago. And she came up with an IPO about 2 weeks ago. And from a zero, her valuation is close to $7 billion in just a matter of 10 days. So that is the scale. That is a scale which people tend to forget about India, the size. And you know what was talked about as a liability, the population, has suddenly become a strength. I mean, everybody talks about data, numbers, scale, where countries' populations are shrinking. You know, it has an economic negative correlation, that the smaller your economy becomes, smaller becomes its economic footprint. The whole demand supply situation changes. But with India, suddenly this has become our strength, our numbers, our data. And that is, the government is also concerned that the way we treat data, you know, new standards have to be set globally. And here we feel that an approach a country takes towards the emerging space of how data will be managed, secrecy, cybersecurity, would also reflect its past. We've been a peace-loving country. We have never invaded. We've only been at the receiving end. We bring values of humanity. We believe that the world is one. That's been part of our scriptures. So on that note, I would say that India is in a good, very good space at this. We do have issues. I mean, all of you are political scientists, historians, 1.3 billion people living in a limited space with diversity, which is mind-boggling. There will be contestations. There will be sectors of the economy which are not moving ahead of the times. The reforms in that particular sector may sometimes face political opposition, regional opposition, etc. But democracy has been a great boon for India, and democracy suggests that you know, every Indian has a free shot at assuming importance, whether in academia, in business, in politics, in sports. Our sports teams today reflect the diversity of India. They don't, our cricket players or badminton players don't necessarily come from elite urban backgrounds. They come from villages, tribal areas. They don't speak English to begin with. But the whole process of merit, of competitiveness, of giving opportunities to a population, even in bureaucracy. When I look at my colleagues in the Foreign Service, they come from all possible backgrounds and from all the different geographies India has. It is not the elite-dominated, English-speaking, urban-centric catchment area or recruitment pool. So that is the strength of India, that we are an open society. And I think that is our strength. Diversity is something we negotiate very well, thanks to a very strong constitutional foundation and a history of tolerance. So let me conclude here by thanking all of my friends here. It's so good to see you. I would also take this opportunity to, in a sense, say bye-bye, because I will be leaving. Enrique, I will be leaving on 14th December. So it's been a wonderful journey for me and the fantastic team I had at the embassy, but I will be in Delhi for the next year or so. And if any one of you happens to be in Delhi at that point of time, it would give me an immense pleasure to invite you for a meal. So please keep that in mind. I will share my numbers to the embassy. And I thank the Spanish Association for Interdisciplinary Study of India for putting this together take this forward, and I will follow the proceedings. I will send you a feedback after I've seen the different papers, and all the best going forward. And thank you. Thank you, amigos. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Honorable Ambassador of India, for, you know, posing this question of where does India stand and sharing your wisdom and your experience from this multiple perspective on what the conference is going to add. And I think that your opening basically set up the tone. So from this question, where does India stand, we are going to move to the place, virtual space, where we are standing at the University of Cantabria, Universidad de Cantabria. It is raining, so if we do that metaphorical journey, it is raining all over Spain. It's raining and raining and raining. It's raining eternities, said a poem. And now we are going to move to University of Cantabria, the place that is making this possible. And we are going to welcome Alfredo Moro Martín, representative of Universidad de Cantabria today.
Good morning. I'm here speaking on behalf of the University of Cantabria and also of its Department of Philology. And first of all, I would like to congratulate the Spanish Association for the Interdisciplinary Study of India on their seventh international conference. I think this conference is a great achievement, and it speaks highly of the vitality and the growing importance of Indian studies in Spain. So congratulations for the conference. And from the perspective of the University of Cantabria, I would like to say that this is a very exciting week for the university, and particularly for our department, as we're hosting both the 44th IDEAN conference and also your seventh international conference. So it's going to be a busy but a very stimulating week, I guess. I would also like to thank the organizing committee, particularly the directors of this conference, Monica Fernandez Jimenez and my great friend Jorge Diego Sanchez, for giving us the chance of participating in the conference. We feel honored, and our only regret is the fact that we will not be able to meet personally, but as the secretary of the committee knows very well, Santander can be a very, very bleak place in November, so maybe it's best to keep it this way. Okay, so I don't want to steal more time from you all, as we have a very tight and stimulating program ahead of us. Welcome to the University of Cantabria, and enjoy this wonderful conference.
Thank you, Alfredo. Thank you for your tender words. It is obviously something that we are missing, this physical connection, but we do share that friendship. And it is actually this friendship that Alfredo and I, for instance, are celebrating today.
I think there seems to be some trouble Jorge's connection.
I think we have lost Jorge, maybe.
It doesn't matter. I know what he's going to say.
Hello?
we lost your connection again, I think.
Hello, am I here?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm sorry. Something went. It says that my net connection is not very stable. So this is. Hi. Now it is working, right?
Yes.
Okay, sorry. So I wanted to celebrate the friendship that I share with Alfredo, and this is the friendship that vertebrates this association and this conference. And for me, after the words by Ambassador and now the words of Alfredo, seeing all your faces, I think, which gives some sort of reason to this gathering. I'm speaking now on behalf of the association. I am the current secretary. I need to excuse the
I think we lost you again, didn't we?
Yeah. Maybe he wants try to find maybe a place where his connection is a bit stronger, can continue perhaps. I think what Jorge was about to say is that what he is today here speaking as on behalf of the association. He had to excuse the president, Antonia Navarro Tejero, because she's in another time zone, so she couldn't join the opening today. And I'm going to wait until Jorge maybe can come back, and I'm going to skip the part where he's going to talk about the association and the philosophy that brings us here together today, and to talk a bit about the program. As he has already said, but just in case for anyone who's joined later, my name is Monica Fernandez, and I am co-directing the conference with Jorge and also with Miguel, who is the secretary today. So once again, I would like to thank the Ambassador of India, the Embassy of India in Spain for their support, as well as the Ministry of Culture and the Association IAE SEVA. And I am very grateful to have been given the opportunity to organize this conference and to have communicated with all the participants for diverse matters. That has allowed me to see where their interests lie and to experience more deeply the humanity and camaraderie that is always at present, always very present in this conference and in this association. I feel closer to everyone who makes an event like this possible, every participant, speaker, attendant, and member of the organization and of the board. We are grateful for the great reception that this online conference has had, despite this being the second year where we've had to host it online. We have sadly not been able to see each other in person this time again, but we believe that the safety of those around us should be of utmost importance to us now. However, I have had a feeling of warmth and proximity organizing this conference, and I can feel the hope that we'll have for the future, being almost certain that the next year we'll be able to see each other in person again. The enthusiasm with which this conference has been received makes me think that our aim has been reached, organizing an event that feels as similar as possible to one on site. Our program is an eclectic document. It harbors participation ranging from graduate students to reputed scholars with a long career behind them, all alike in sincerity and critical analysis. As in previous editions, we are using both English and Spanish as official languages of the conference, and thus we have the possibility to listen to contributions coming from different areas of expertise. There are talks related to the world of arts, such as dance, music, and performance, and talks devoted to the political sciences. In the realms of history, we will be able to learn about topics as diverse as the diaspora of indentured workers, colonial Kerala, or the status of sexual minorities. As part of the world of literature, there will be interesting conversations about female literature, both on the partition and on diasporic experiences. We will also listen to ideas about Indian cinematic adaptation. As you can see, coinciding with the 75th anniversary of the independence of India, our conference has set the task to explore the many Indias that lie outside and inside the country. And we have only achieved this thanks to our participants who have all the merit and who always, as always, have surprised us with an outstanding display of original critical thinking. So to finish with, we are thankful to our plenary speakers who will lead four sessions of talks, workshops, and conversations of the highest standards. As organizers, we are deeply humbled by the wonderful program that we have ahead. And it is our ultimate hope that it is greatly enjoyed by everyone present. So I was going to say, let's not delay the beginning of this exciting conference more, but I think we have Jorge here again, so we're going to go back to the previous section. I hope this works now.
I'm sorry.
Talking about the program in the meantime. Yeah.
Thank you, Monica. I'm sorry. Something went wrong with my net. I just wanted to say probably what you were referring to, Monica, that, you know, this association is an association of human beings trying to make sense of where does India stand, as the ambassador was expressing. Alfredo Moro Martín, our representative from University of Cantabria, started claiming that we have a great friendship, which is absolutely true and which makes this event being held online more difficult. But this is the friendship that we are celebrating today between you and I, as well as
anytime he mentions our friendship, something goes wrong. So I guess that there's a cosmic.
There is something. Anyways, I'm going to be very short. I'm going to cut it short. I'm going to just excuse the presence of the president of the association, Antonia Navarro Tejero, who cannot join us today, and just make sense of this 7 international conference within the trajectory of the association. This is the 7 international conference, and we have held also the same amount of seminars, always trying to make sense of where does India stand. And we exist because you are with us today, because you have been here with us for 15 years, and this is what we want to celebrate today. And on behalf of the board of La Junta Directiva, we want to express our gratitude for sending your abstracts, for still, you know, giving so much time and effort to the association despite the conditions. It was a great commitment that we had to meet in person in Santander, and still you are here once again, 1 year after last year on the space, and we really like hugging each other, but still we are here online and we are trying to make the best and serve always the best. And as a co-director, I just want to say that this is possible because Mónica Fernández Jiménez and Miguel Ángel Sebastián Martín are there behind. They've been basically managing everything, all the IT, all the technical issues, my own technical issues as of now. And this is something that happens because these two great colleagues and friends are there. Also, there are three women who are not now, but who would be taking care of the sessions. Their names are Marta Aguadero, Laura Gómez Lucas, and Elena Frances de Castro. And they are MA students who would be co-coordinating the sessions so that problems such as the one I'm having can be solved as fast as possible. And you know, this is the 7 international conference. The title was celebrated by the ambassador. We are here by celebrating our presence in this cyber space, celebrating our passion and study of India. And I think this is the time for us to light up the fire and start this
Jorge could not finish without another interruption.
So Monica, please, you can close.
Yes, before we officially let the conference begin.
Thank you.
Just wanted to say the next sessions are going to start in 10 minutes. We, if you stay in this room, we have a round table titled Diaspora and Post-Nationalism in Indo-Caribbean Writing and in room B. And if you can, Miguel, can you paste the link on the chat? We have a session, a panel in Spanish titled Identidad en las Artes. So if you want to listen to the first panel, you can stay here, just silence your microphone, your camera if you want, or you can chat with each other, and you can click on the link that we're shortly going to paste on the chat if you want to attend the other session. And that said, thank you very much, Jorge. Let us not delay the beginning of this exciting couple of days with more talking. Welcome everyone to the 7th International Conference of the Spanish Association for the Interdisciplinary Study of India. And thank you very much for joining us in the opening. Thank you, Ambassador, for being here and staying.